हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल। आई प्रोफेसर प्रशांत भुवा, डॉक्टर सुभाष टेक्निकल कैंपस जूनागढ़। वी आर ऑन लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ डिज़ाइन ऑफ रेनफोर्स कंक्रीट स्ट्रक्चर, सेवन सेमेस्टर बी सिविल। और टुडेज टॉपिक इज सेस्मिक एनालिसिस ऑफ आरसी बिल्डिंग। सो दिस वन इज लेक्चर 8। इन प्रीवियस 7 लेक्चर सीरीज we discuss about earthquake resistance design of building, in that what is the importance of earthquake resistance design philosophy itself, which are the techniques to improve the earthquake resisting force, what is the design capacity concept, how we improve the ductility of building, how to improve the stiffness of building, what should be the different modes of failure while earthquake is occurs. So one of the very important method to analyze a seismic force, or you can say the horizontal force on building, is nothing but seismic analysis of RCC building. So today in this lecture series we will discuss about seismic analysis of RCC building, which type of method to analyze the seismic force, which one is very conventional to use a high rise building, what are the codal provision has suggest to analyze this seismic force. So start with the seismic analysis of RCC building. So since the earthquake force are random in nature and unpredictable, so the static and dynamic analysis of the structure have become primary concern of being as a civil engineer. So we know that we not predictable the intensity of earthquake, what is the nature of earthquake, how it should be occur, which time, which place, that we unpredictable. So being as a civil engineer, we are concerned about the analysis of static as well as dynamic through the building. So we can conduct the earthquake resisting building while it should be capable to resist horizontal force. So the main parameter of seismic analysis of structure are load carrying capacity, ductility, stiffness, damping and mass. So there are the different method of analysis which provide the different degree of accuracy, but the analysis process can be classified basis on these three factors that I say, that load carrying capacity, ductility, stiffness, damping of mass. So the analysis of structural model selected on this parameter are should be different. We already discussed about in previous lecture series regarding load carrying capacity in terms of design capacity concept, while we improve the ductility itself, stiffness itself, what should be the damping, and how the mass of building should be affect while we calculating the earthquake resisting building itself. So today in this method we have to use IS 1893-2003. It is very useful code to carry out or analysis by seismic analysis of any multi-story building. So throughout this seismic coefficient method we have to use IS 1893 part 1 2002 to analyze or carry out the seismic force while the building should be occurs. Now the seismic analysis of structure itself, so analysis types that should be used in analysis the structure, it depends on which are the parameter of a structure, it depends on this method. Is first one is external action, which type of external action should be act on a building, what should be the behavior of structure, or you can say the structural material behavior. And third one, the type of structural model should be selected. So there are the very different model should be selected to perform this analytic procedure. So these are the mainly three parameter on the structure depends through this method. So there are the different analysis procedure are, first one is linear static analysis, second one is non-linear static analysis, third one is linear dynamic analysis, and fourth one is non-linear dynamic analysis. So the linear static analysis, or you can say the equivalent static analysis, can only be used for regular structure with the limited height. So there are the some limitation of linear static analysis, or you can say the equivalent static analysis. While the linear dynamic analysis can be performed in two way. While we discuss about the linear dynamic analysis, it should be performed by two way. Which way? First one is response vector method. Please note it down. This one is very important. And second one is elastic time history method. So as far as linear dynamic analysis is concerned, we have to carry it out by two way. Either we go for response vector method or we go for elastic time history method. So the significant difference between the linear static and linear dynamic analysis is to level of the force and their distribution along the height of structure. So mainly, what are the difference between linear static analysis and linear dynamic analysis is all about the distribution of different story height of building and how should be calculating the force at different story height, or you can say the level of different building. So there are the mainly four way the procedure of analysis should be done. Now we start about the first method is nothing but linear static analysis, or you can say the equivalent static analysis method. So the earthquake lateral force analysis, the design of lateral force shall first be compute for the building as well. So what should be the first step? First humko building ka total load hai lateral force or count karna hai. Based on lateral force we identify the design lateral force shall be the distributed to the various floor. After the calculating the lateral force, we will calculate distributing different floor level. So for that, there are the two commonly used procedure to finding out the seismic force, or you can say the seismic design lateral force. One of the method is equivalent static force method, or you can say the linear static analytic method, and second one is our dynamic analysis. So in general, in actual practice, the both method are very important, because just because of calculating the static way, it not given the significant result while we not conduct the dynamic analysis. So both the way we have to analyze the building, especially when you construction of building are in a very severe zone of earthquake itself. So earthquake equivalent static force analysis, the concept of this dynamic analysis into the partially dynamic and partially static analysis to finding the maximum displacement. So this method, as I told earlier, it depends on the dynamic as well as static. So partially we have conduct the dynamic analysis and partially we have to take static analysis, and that's why it gives the maximum displacement finding out. So it's restrict only a single mode of vibration of structure. So the equivalent static lateral force analysis in a base on following assumption. So we make through some assumption before we calculating or go through the equivalent static force analysis method is concerned. Which are the assumption? These assumption are very important, and in somewhere it should be asking the theory part of you. Write down the equivalence assumption of equivalent static force analysis. So these are the assumption. First assumption is, assume that structure is rigid. We know that at every element or every component, we not predict that our structure is rigid. But for the this method is concerned, we have to assume that our structure is rigid. Also assume that perfect fixity between structure and foundation. So we have to assume that our structure should be perfectly fixed with the foundation. Third one is, during the ground motion, every point of structure experience the same acceleration. In general, in practice, we know that the previous lecture, it not should be possible, but we have to assume that. Fourth one is, dominating the effect of earthquake is equivalent to the horizontal force varying magnitude over the height. We have to assume the earthquake force as a horizontal force, and it should be a varying at different height of building. And last one, approximately determinate the total horizontal force, or you can say the base shear on structure. So we have to not calculating perfectly on a acting horizontal force on building, but we have to calculate approximately. So based on this approximately value of base shear, we compute the different model of building, and further we have to analyze for the earthquake resisting system itself. So this method, as I tell you, also known as equivalent static method, because based on that assumption we have to compute all equivalent force to the building and also distributing very equally, and that's why the name itself equivalent static method. So based on the formula given in a particular IS 1893 code, we have to follow this code and to practice analysis the building itself. So general step to carry out this method is, first of all, we calculating the design base shear on as a whole building, and after the calculating the base shear, the distribution along the height of building we have to carry out. So फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल हमको क्या फाइंड करना है, टोटल बेस सीयर बिल्डिंग का फाइंड करना है. कैसे फाइंड करना है वो आगे हम देखेंगे, क्या कोड हमको यूज करना है. आफ्टर फाइंडिंग द बेस सीयर, हमको उसको डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करना है इक्वली हाइट ऑफ बिल्डिंग, एंड देन द लेटरल फोर्स एट ईच फ्लोर लेवल दस ऑप्टेन एंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड इक्वली लेटरल लोड रेजिस्टिंग एलिमेंट. आफ्टर द फाइंडिंग आउट द बेस सीयर, हमको फाइंड करना है लेटरल फोर्स और उसको भी डिफरेंट स्टोरी में डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करना है. दिस ऑल अबाउट द मेथड ऑफ दिस लिनियर स्टैटिक एनालिसिस, और यू कैन से द इक्विवेलेंट स्टैटिक एनालिसिस मेथड. नाउ व्हाट आर द लिमिटेशन व्हाइल वी यूज दिस मेथड. सो वन लिमिटेशन दैट शुड बी डिस्कस इन अवर एजम्पशन साइड, देर आर द अगेन थ्री लिमिटेशन फॉर द पर्टिकुलर दिस मेथड इज, यू नॉट यूज द हाई सेस्मिक जोन एंड हाइट ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर. While your building is constructed very severe zone, at that time it's not given the perfectly result. As I tell in assumption part, it should be given approximate result. So that's why it's very risky to carry out this method. Second one is building having higher modes of vibration than the fundamental mode, then itself in that case particular we cannot use this method. Third one is structure having significant discontinuity in mass and stiffness along the height. So where some type of structure there have the mass discontinuity, that will be discussed in depth in our lecture 5th. What should be the irregularity in plan and what should be the discontinuity of mass. So there are also the significant effect while we calculating or using this method. So these are the three limitation itself particular using or analysis this method. So now first of all we calculate design seismic base shear, as I tell earlier, and which type of code we have to use. So we have to use IS 1893-2002. Please note it down, you not go for old code, you have to follow IS 1893-2002 only, because there are lots of change during the revision of 2002 earthquake itself. So first of all we follow the clause number 7.5.3 is all about the VB. So design seismic base shear is denoted by VB, and VB is expressed by AH into W, where AH is nothing but horizontal seismic coefficient and W is seismic weight of building. So before we finding out base shear, first of all we calculating the W. What is W? W is a seismic weight of building. So at different story, or you can say floor wise, it should be varies. Suppose what are the conclude in seismic weight as per your knowledge. So we conclude the seismic weight in different floor, like dead weight of slab, weight of beams, weight of column, weight of floor, weight of masonry wall, that all should be covered under the seismic weight particular any floor wise. Next, AH. So AH is a horizontal seismic coefficient, is given the equation on the clause number 6.4.2. AH is equal to Z multiply by I multiply by S divide by 2 times R into Z. So Z has a different phenomena, I is a different phenomena, SA by G is a combined one phenomena, and R. So particular four phenomena we have to calculate or express calculation before we calculating the AH. So providing the any structure T is less than 0.1, the value of AH will be not taken less than Z by 2, whatever be the value of I bar A. So it's directly depend on our natural fundamental time of building itself. Now we have to discuss thoroughly with the difference expression of this equation. First one is Z. So capital Z is denoted as a zone factor. How we calculate? We go forward the further slide. I is important factor. R is response reduction factor. SA by G, as I tell you, it should be a combined effect, not individually SA and G. SA by G is average response acceleration coefficient, and T is undamped natural PDR of structure. So there are the two way, either damped natural PDR or undamped. So especially in this method is concerned, we have to calculate undamped natural PDR of structure. Now how we calculate zone factor Z? So what is the zone factor Z itself? First of all, so it is the indicator of maximum seismic risk characterized by the maximum consideration of earthquake is known as MCE in a zone which the structure is located. So our building is located in which zone of earthquake, based on that it should be classified under 2, 3, 4 or 5 respectively. So IS 1893 part 1 have give the characterized on the different classify based on the structure is located. So the table given in clause number 6.4.2 have given the different value of Z as located at our building in very different seismic zone. So it's all about the zone factor Z. Next, we have to find out average response acceleration coefficient is nothing but SA by G. So SA by G, it depends on type of rock or the soil site and also the natural PDR of damping of structure. So it depend on our building located on which types of soil, or you can say the which type of rock, and what should be our natural PDR of building itself. So it's obtained the clause number 6.4.5 in IS 1893-2002. Next one is important factors R. So I. So it depends on the occupancy category of building, and it is the obtained from table 6, clause number 6.4.2. So I is a importance factors, means what should be the building has important functionality. For example, if I construct the hospital building, so that importance of society is very, because there are the lots of people are at the same time of particular function itself, or you can say the hospitality itself. So at that time the importance of building is high. So likewise, the building has characterized on the same clause, and for that it gives the important factors of a particular building. So you have to identify our building is located in which characterized, and for that you have to compute the important factors according to clause number 6.4.2. So the site class is also determined based on the average property of soil, but within a certain depth of 30 meter. We have to not just taken 1 to 5 meter average property. We have to at least check certain depth, how many meters of depth we have to check, 30 meter as per the code is suggest, and then should be give the perfect subsurface investigation of soil itself. Next, our expression is response reduction factor is denoted by R. So it is determined by the types of lateral load resisting system. Now again, R is given the table 7 on the clause of 6.4.2, and the table has classified the different element that we have to use to resist the earthquake force. So we discuss about in previous lecture series there are the lots of methods to improve the earthquake force. Now, in previous lecture 7, we specially discuss about a shear wall. That is the one of the best option to resist this lateral force. So likewise, which element have to use in a building to carry out the lateral force, based on the R it should be different. For example, ordinary RC moment resisting frame is denoted by OMRF. That value of R is 3. Now suppose you have to use a shear wall in a building. So now your building should be becomes a case of special RC moment resisting frame. It means SMRF. Then your R should be 5. So likewise, it should be varies when you have to use the lateral load resisting system. It means हम अपनी बिल्डिंग में लेटरल लोड रेजिस्ट करने के लिए कौन सा एलिमेंट यूज कर सकते हैं और कौन सी मेथड यूज कर रहे हैं उसके ऊपर हमारा आर डिपेंड है. इज नथिंग बट आवर रिस्पॉन्स रिडक्शन फैक्टर. सो दिस ऑल अबाउट द आर. नाउ नेक्स्ट वन इज फंडामेंटल पीडियर. सो दिस फंडामेंटल नेचुरल टाइम पीडियर इज गिवन इन क्लोज नंबर 7.6 एंड इज डिनोटेड बाय TA. सो फॉर ब्रिक इनफिल पैनल means in periphery of frame structure we have to use as a brick infill panel. At that time TA should be 0.0075 H raised to 0.75, while H is a height of building for RCC frame building. So and for the steel frame it should be 0.085 H raised to 0.75, while we have to start at the lecture series of RCC building. So that's why we have to use right now the first equation of TA. And without infill panel, there should be the equation of TA. Without infill panel, it should be the equation. If you have to use infill panel, then TA should be calculated same way. But what should be the change? You have to modify TA is equal to 0.09 times under root D, where H is equal to height of building for first case, and second case D is a bed dimension of building in plinth level. So in both criteria TA should be different, either without brick infill panel or with infill panel. So I think the data should be given in your numerical example, either your panel should be brick infill or without, otherwise you have to assume that. So after the calculating of base shear, our next step is to calculate the lateral force induce any particular level of HI as per the clause given in IS 1893 is nothing but 7.7.1, and expression you have to notice that QI is equal to VB multiplied by WI HI square divided by summation of WJ HI square, where QI is a design lateral force I. At different floor level the QI should be different. Same way, because our seismic weight of floor are different at different story height, that means I is indicate the different story, like first floor, second floor, third floor, likewise number of floor given in our building, and N indicate the number of story in a building or number of level at which mass are located. So this is the final step to calculating the lateral force. Again, I repeated the step-by-step procedure to finding out the lateral load, or you can say the seismic coefficient method. So very first step, depending on the location of building, site identification and seismic zone, you have to assign or calculating zone factor Z. And how it should be calculated? So use the table number 2 along with the seismic zone of map. On otherwise you have to use annexe is given on IS 1893. So based on these two way you can identify the value of Z. Step number 2, compute the seismic weight of building is denoted by capital W. As per the clause 7.4.2, you have to calculate seismic weight of floor, and as per the clause number 7.4.3, you have to calculate seismic weight of building. So likewise, using this both the clause, you finally compute the seismic weight of building. Step number 3, after the calculating the base seismic weight, compute the natural time period TA. As I earlier, the different clause has given 7.6.1, or you can say use 7.6.2. In case should be vary of different building. So this all about step number 3, just you have to calculate TA. Step number 4, obtain the data on the type of soil condition of the foundation of building. You have to calculating the soil investigation, obtaining the data, assign the type 1 for the height soil, 2 for medium soil and 3 for soft soil. So based on this data you have to identify, you have to obtain the foundation of building itself. So step number 5, using the site soil investigation, you have to use the TA and soil type that I tell earlier, step number 4, 1 for hard, 2 for medium and 3 for loose. So according to this soil type and TA that already we have to calculate in step number 3, both are compute for average acceleration, average spectrum restoration is denoted as SA by G. So for the computing the SA by G value, you needed two value. First one is natural time period TA that already we have to calculate, and second soil type, either it should be hard, medium or soil. So there are the two way to identify the SA by G. Either you have to use figure number 2 or corresponding the table. So in the both the way you have to compute SA by G. So this all about step number 5. Step 6, assign the value of important factors is denoted by R, and it depends on the occupancy and functionality of the structure, occupy and functionality of structure itself. So as I tell earlier, our building, what should be the important factor? So that given in clause number 7.2, table number 6, IS 1893. So just you have to remind the clause number. Step number 7, assign the value of response reduction factor R. It's also depending on the type of structure, that which type of lateral load system used in our building. Likewise, you have to calculating the R according to clause number 7.2 and use table number 7 in IS 1893. Step number 8, after the knowing of value Z, SA by G, R and I, our four expression to use the AH. So after knowing this value, compute the design horizontal acceleration coefficient, and is nothing but denoted by AH. AH equation is given on clause number 6.4.2, Z, SA, I, 2, G and R. So this equation are already given in clause number 6.4.2. After calculating the AH, we compute the design seismic base shear, and is denoted by VB. So VB is expressed by AH into W. So W is already calculating in very previous step, and finally we find out base shear according to clause number 7.5.3. This is the step number 9. Step number 10, compute the design lateral force QI at different I means different story height. So we compute the design lateral force at different story level. After computing or completing the design lateral force, our last step is to compute the design lateral force QI particular floor by distributing and design web shear as per the expression. So after the calculating the QI according to base shear, we have to distribute it at different story I. So QI, how we calculate QI? So expression is given in clause number 7.7.1, VB into WI into HI square divided by summation of WI HI square. So likewise, after the calculation of base shear using this clause, we have to compute the load distribution at different story height, and finally we have to draw the graph of base shear through the building. So it's all about to identify a lateral force using seismic coefficient method. So please remember this all 10 step. It's very useful to start with the numerical of seismic coefficient method, and it's also help if the theory is arc, discuss which other step is compute to finding out the design lateral force. So in a both a way, this step is very important. So I think you have to clear about the all 10 step regarding the finding out the lateral force. Within which method we have to use is nothing but seismic coefficient method. So I think you have to clear with all 10 step. Still, if you have any doubt, so write in comment box of my YouTube channel. I will be given the answer for the same. Thank you students, and next lectures we have to start the numerical of seismic coefficient method. Thank you everyone.